that default. So there should be multiple reasons why a fluid would default. I said there could be one reason could be a physical stress which you are applying, or in case of gases, let's say, or even liquids, let's say there is a pressure difference. Pressure, what is the pressure difference? High and low. So there is one location where the pressures are high, and there is another location which is low pressure. So due to that pressure difference, things would flow. That fluid would tend to flow. Ultimately, the pressure also translates into that kind of force which is causing the fluid to flow. So, shear stress can come either due to pressure difference or physical application. That's important. Now, a stress. Somebody stress. Let me write, I am not going to do it. Stress is force per unit area. Right? Force, is it a scalar vector or what? What is stress? That's what? How many for a scalar? What is it? Then one. How many for vector? That was scratching the head as if the other is that it's not you. The impression does not get damaged. Okay, there is something known as a tensor. Have you ever heard of that word?
Yes.
Where? Tensor. Not tension. That is too much of a psychic source. That is not that tension. It's a tensor. I just want this word, just put it in your hard disk somewhere deep, very far registry. Just put that word. Don't allow it to come out. Right? If somebody asks you, you are in an academic gathering, let's say, otherwise you talk about it, these things. Right? Let's say there are a bunch of people and you want to make an impression. Right? And you say that, oh, stress, yeah, I know, it's a tensor. And I go to other class as well, change that topic right away. Because the next thing which people are going to ask you, you have no clue. So make an impression and then ask, how is the weather today? Right? Otherwise, you will be in deep, deep trouble. Make an impression, don't let it fall down. Just casually, yeah, I know, it's a tensor. That's it. Because there is something known as a scalar vector and then tensor. So let's say scalar is a number, I will write a number 4. Vector is 1, 2, and 3. And which is generally known as a matrix, is actually a second order tensor. A second order tensor. But that's what I am saying. Put it deep down in your heart disk and leave it for a few years. So whoever goes for his higher education, MS, PhD, and somebody tells you the word tensor, so then grab it and bring it there. That you heard this in your undergrad. Right? Direction of a tangent, that is a shearing stress, and that causes causes this deformation. Genetic stress is somehow related to these tau. This is sigma. These are different tau. Okay, these are the things which I started with molecular structure and molecular cohesive forces and all these details, right? But which level we are talking about? Molecules. As an engineer, I gave you an example last time that we make a dash to the gate and tell something about the phenomenon, an approximation. So every time if somebody asks you what is the pressure in the room, and you start, oh, okay, there is one molecule, let me get hold of an atomic microscope so that I can see molecules moving, and then you kind of start doing analysis on each molecule that you are doing. It's not possible. It's not possible, I think, most of the time. There is something known as molecular dynamics simulations, where you track each molecule, how is it going to behave. That requires tons of supercomputers. We are not going into that level. As an engineer, we kind of try to get approximations. So one of the key approximations is that rather than looking at each molecule, what we do is we talk of average. That's a bunch, a packet there, the pressure is this much here, pressure is that much here. So we try to kind of combine those molecules and talk at a macro level. Macro level generally is, I would say, in my definition, where you can see at least with your eye. And this region, what I'm talking about, a macro level, is in fact the average of all the molecules the way they behave. So there is a micro level, we are not going into that. Again, there's a huge study at micro level as well, but at this stage, we focus on macro level. That is, we take averages of those molecule structures and come up with something. There is a difference between micro and macro levels. So let's see. If I am talking about something like this, what is this? A cube with a dimension of 1 millimeter. This is the exaggerated figure because 1 millimeter is really, really small. So we have about 10 power 18 molecules of gases. Similarly, we have for nucleus. That means that within 1 millimeter cube, we have this much of molecules. Impossible to track all of them. But we can at least see that 1 millimeter cube. Can make some approximation. So whatever parameters we are going to identify with that 1 millimeter cube, that is in fact the average of this much these molecules which are acting in that cube. Right? So we basically characterize the behavior. Let me write that word. This is a technical word, so let's use that. One more test. These are the keywords for every sentence. We want to characterize the behavior. That is the fact what we are doing us, we are going to take out. That's the whole point. Clear? Now, what happens? Within that small element, a cubic element, some of the molecules may be dumb. That means they don't care to move, they are moving very slow. Few of the molecules might move very fast, right? They just want to bang everybody. So now you see a difference of behavior with the molecules, yes. But we are concentrating on the average. Right? Another thing on top of it is that we want to make sure that all of them, they are behaving the same way. What is the real picture? The real picture is that some molecules are dumb, some are fast, some are okay, some are average, right? So just like a class, you are good, you are bad, you are crazy, right? You are smart. But I want to kind of put you guys in one box, neutral box, and such that everybody is exactly the same. But what I am talking about is not real. Right? So I have to make an assumption that all the students, they are exactly the same. They know their knowledge is exactly the same. They behave exactly the same. So this is what I am doing is an assumption. It's not true. Same is true with the liquid or the fluids. I am going to assume that each molecule is going to behave exactly the same. And that hypothesis which I am going to make is a very important hypothesis. Do you know what is hypothesis? Because anything which you say yes, I have the license to pass that exam. Right, I got the license. So if it appears like that, I don't cry afterwards, it is recorded. Right. So I have a group. So, we are going to make an assumption which is known as
I think the premise
that I gave you is very much clear. And what is the starting of it? It is very interesting that long time back, maybe 100 years back, after almost the exact time, people started to learn this physics and they realized that these waves, they are transformed from one place to another to a medium. So they need a medium. Like if I'm talking, because of the air, you can listen. Because of the pressure wave and all these kind of complex physics involved in it. So people were kind of surprised that how the sunlight can reach Earth has come to a medium. So whatever is in the space, they thought that it is filled with a fluid. But there is a medium. And that was known as ether. That is what ether. But later on they discovered light has some dual phenomena, dual nature, all these kind of stuff. Ultimately, that was an hypothesis which was proven wrong later. Right? So, this is that kind of, it's not proven wrong, but it has certain limitations as well, which we are going to discuss. So, there is a dog. Right? The dog. Basically, what it means is talk about quite a long time in this, but then I got some other training as well. So I'm trying to kind of not switch between the two things. Right? So that's good. Anyways, coming back to the subject, we have someone. Let's say I'm talking about that deliberative thing. I call this thing as this is kind of a millimeter. In order to measure those elements, I call that length scale as lowercase l. Yeah? Now, if I have to measure the distance between molecules, let's say there are tons of molecules. I call that answer as measure if I am interested in finding the distance between those two molecules, any two molecules. Right. The way it is defined, the molecular length scale is known as actually, another time you have heard it, mean free cross during your mean free cross. Yep? No? Yes?
that is the mean.
we have talked about these two things. Now let's have another scale. Let's say all those. Yeah. My instructor used to say that an aerospace engineer will be able to draw an airfoil in one go, go and revive your aerodynamics. So maybe I'll still, I don't want to do that. I know enough aerodynamics. Right? But I was talking about that millimeter thing. This is in fact 1 millimeter thing. And this is a wing of an aircraft. This is a cross section of a wing of an aircraft, which is just what length scale are we talking about? Kilometers? How many meters?
Mathematical version, they should couple it with the English version.
question will be answered in the English version, they will be able to comprehend in the mathematical form also. So that's something which is very important. Now, before I write something, there are certain numbers, some dimensionless forms, which are very important in order to have an idea. Let's say if I get hold of the average height of a person in Pakistan. And let's say I ask the rest of the people that what is your height? So rather than telling it is 5 feet 9 inches, right? So that unit may not be applicable in other part of the world. So in order to make it a non-dimensional unit, let's say we take the average of all the human beings and we come up with some number. And then you say my height is in fact 1.2 as a two units. People would already know that, oh, we are talking about the average height as this one. So anybody who wants to convert it to their own units. But these dimensionless numbers are very important in order to kind of realize what is happening. So that everybody is on the same page. So you define a characteristic length, just like the characteristic height, that's the average height, and then you make it a reference. And then you talk in terms of those things. Yes? And if you go, let's say, to the United States, the average height might be different. So they put their own average height and they come up with 0.8, 1.2. And in terms of engineering, solid mechanics, fluid mechanics, or another form, another subject, it is a dream to have those number, dimensionless numbers associated with your name. The first guy who came up with some dimensionless number, he would put his own name on that. Reynolds number, Stroll number, Weber number, true number. You might have heard this in some other subjects as well, but it's a dream, especially for mathematicians, that they can attach the name and build their legacy. Right? So let's see who after maybe 30 years down the road has his own number. Either you can create your own and try to be famous. Right? So let's see. Anyway, person who was talking about in terms of these things was this guy. Does this make sense? Lambda is so small and this one is huge. So lambda one has to be very, very, very smaller than 1. It's quite obvious, right? And I don't want to write it, but I'll just spell it out, don't have my time. So this number is a dimensionless number defined as a ratio. It's a dimensionless number. And I put a red dot on this, so you know my consequence. That's it. It's a dimensionless number defined as a ratio of the molecular mean free path. The ratio of the molecular mean free path length to a representative physical length scale. It's the ratio of the molecular mean free path length to a representative physical length scale. So already defined mean free path, so you already know it. As a ratio of the molecular mean free path length to a representative physical length scale.
Give you an example.
I think this is not in your book. So, all those who have spent their time, or any others at all, I have a book at home, so I don't have too much. You better try it there. I'm not sure. I think that's your word. There is one new word we might want to different regimes. So whenever you are doing some analysis, flow past a vein, flow in a pipe, a fluid structure interaction somewhere, right? Wet analysis. So there is some characteristic length which you are talking about. Right? And lambda you know based on what fluid you are using. So you know that is it honey, it is water, it is air, but so lambda that molecular length scale you know. And the kind of experiment that you are doing, you also know the length of the wing, cylinder, table, let's say. So you know capital, the uppercase L as well. So now if you do this lambda over L, you come up with a number. And obviously, whatever we are doing, the altitude at which we are living, the molecules, they are still closely packed. In 1 millimeter cube, it's at 10 power 21 molecules for liquid. And that amounts to at 10 power minus 7 millimeters distance between the molecules. So, lambda L is very small. Like you said, less than 1 millimeter. So, this number would come out to be very small somewhere in. And that's what I call a continuum flow regime. And this gas, what is we would throughout this FM1, FM2, we will kind of analyze this. Again, if somebody dares enough, he wants to go into this region, if your Knudsen number, whatever analysis you are doing, if you are in a region where the molecules, they are far away, the lambda will be more. Right? If the molecules are far, your lambda will be higher. So if lambda is higher, this number will kind of increase. If you are in this range, this is known as split flow regime. Slightly rarefied. This is the technical word, rarefied. Similarly, if it is in this range, transition regime, moderately rarefied. And if it is this, what does that mean? Let's say you are traveling on a shuttle. You know what is a shuttle? It's not that this rickshaw with the ground, no. Space shuttle, right? Let's say if you go high up in the air, you are going to space. So a region at a certain altitude in terms of kilometer, which comes where there is, if you have atomic microscope or a goggle, you can say that there is one molecule, or there's another one, and your colleague says, oh, I see another one down there. They are so far away. So what is big is lambda. Let's say the characteristic length is the wing of your space shuttle, which is let's say 3 meters, and you can see molecules like 300 meters apart. 300 meters. And your wing is, let's say, the characteristic length is 3 meters. So lambda is like 300 meters divided by 3 is like 100. That number comes out to be 100. So we are talking of something in this region. This is a free molecular. So you are flying at that level. Because you are going to the space, and space you won't find any molecule, but in the middle, somewhere, you are in that. So all this theory that fails, this fails because what it is no more continuum. You have to come up with some other analysis. So that's where this re-entry of space shuttle back into the atmosphere, that is kind of interesting field. Right, because kind of heat generated and all those things. There's a very interesting phenomena which is known as in this last we are talking aerodynamic skip. How many of you know that? No? Okay, anybody who has kind of disgusted, frustrated, standing on the side of a lake, gets hold of like a pebble or something, and he goes like, ah, come on. And then chuck, chuck, chuck. Goes like that. for your entire time?
Yes, sir.
A bunch of frustrated guys. Right? It skipped. It did not go into the water, it skipped a few times. So, very interesting phenomenon is the space shuttle is coming back. The atmosphere is like a wall. If it does not come with a right angle to that atmosphere, it would skip. So the pilots, they have to maintain a certain angle in order to go into the atmosphere again, in order to come back. Otherwise, this aerodynamic skip happens. Very interesting phenomenon. I am not going to put a dot in it because it's in this range. The exam is only coming in three. I cannot ask, I don't have the money to do that. Anyways, we have missed few classes, I tried to compensate it some other time. But as of now, good. I don't know, I have not seen it. Anyways, since the class is being recorded as well, there is some issue with that computer thingy. So what I have is some language, one of you has already pointed out yesterday that they don't like that methodology of writing on something like a stencil and it appears on the board. I'll try it for 2 lectures and see how it goes. And based on your feedback, I'll change this time. But all this crappy stuff which I'm writing, I'll try to write it like with the help of computer stencil. It should appear there and you can make notes. And I'll try to kind of say it through slightly. And we'll see how it goes. The feedback is not good, but let me try. Otherwise, I don't see your slides. So that's something which might, not go well. Okay. This guy is present. Present. Anyway, next.
Present.
Yeah,
next.
Yeah.
And try that new technique.